Hello and welcome to the Music Smoothie. All right, welcome to the Music Smoothie, everyone, where we all just hang out. We have this. Okay, so we have our blender.
We hop in.
Yeah, we throw in a bunch of music nerds, and then we throw in their song picks on top, and then their opinions about the song picks on top of that, and then we hit puree, and then we dump out the contents into your eardrum, and hopefully you don't get an infection. Because that's not covered under our insurance plan. All right. So first up, let's introduce everyone. I am Laz. I will be your gracious host, and I'll try not to play anything dumb. Next, we have... great intro for me. Fishy, tell us about yourself in 18 words or less.
Oh, I can't count that quick. I am a guy who just likes music in general. Don't have too much experience playing any, but I can give opinions, I guess.
All right, we have our good friend GS. Say a few words.
Few words.
You can do that for yours.
Great.
I'm blanking, sorry. I listen to music, and I have opinions.
Alright, I guess that's all we need to know. Alright, we have... Wait, did you say what you want to go by for this, Dave? Or...
Oh, yeah, that's fine. My name's Dave, but I also go by a stage name online of Princeton Vice. I'm a online horror host, you know, hosting old movies like Elvira and stuff like that, in that style online. I pretty much love a little bit of all music, and but I mostly have experience with music theater and also a lot of kind of gothabilly stuff. And I wish a stupid was on the chopping block before, because I definitely would have brought something stupid. I'll have to try harder next time.
All right. And then finally, we've got Billy.
I'm Billy. I was hit by a car, and that has affected my music sensibilities greatly. Now I can only listen to lo-fi sad music, and that's all you need to know about me.
That is surprisingly accurate, and I was there for that, and it gave me mild PTSD at the time.
But you got better.
I got better.
Autism cured.
Now you're a lizard.
Very good. All right, so we're going to play some music for you guys. We didn't decide on order.
Nose game.
GS will go first. He has a good opener for us.
I didn't say it was good. I said it's an opener.
Oh, he has a bad opener for us.
That's funny.
Bring on the bad opener.
I've got a good closer. Bad opener, good closer.
All right, the order is getting established.
I didn't say it was bad.
All right, he's got a mediocre opener.
I didn't make any value judgments other than that it's an opener.
He's got an opener.
All right.
Who's got an opening?
I think we all have orifices.
Really? I've cauterized.
All of your openings?
it's the only way. It's like the X-Files.
Orifices, isn't that kind of flower?
It can be. Just look at... Who's the artist?
obligatory. I have.
Georgia O'Keefe.
Yeah.
I knew you were stepping in there.
Anyway.
Oh.
Yeah, let's get on to the show.
All right. So middle three. So first up, we've got GS, and then
I'll go.
Let's start there. We'll play it by ear.
All right. Well.
Literally.
Okay. What? Well. Look at
you gotta keep. He's going to bring something low key and folky. We should have something else that isn't that after to break it up.
That's fair. I got some stuff that is not low key and folky today.
All right. So. Right.
And then after you, I could go because I have something low key for my first one, and then my second one is not low key.
Loki Lysmith?
I was about to say, the first thing that came to mind. Everything is. This is the all Scandinavian episode, right?
Yes.
Nay.
I have bleached my skin.
You can bleach your skin, but you can't change within.
And what's in within is ABBA.
Are you the dancing queen?
There's our guide.
I burned down the house in honor of the Scandinavian episode.
You'll have to join a band and then stab someone for real cred.
That's my next act.
Yeah, Scandinavian black metal is all about the...
It's all about the aesthetic.
Yeah.
The lifestyle.
No, anyway. I want to hear a Scandinavian black metal version of Dancing Queen, you know?
Oh, I'm sure it exists.
Well, that would be ironic because, you know, how much they hated ABBA.
I think they just hated disco in general.
We love the things we hate.
No, but they actually threatened to kill the members of ABBA.
That means they really love them.
I mean, raise your hand. Who hasn't threatened to kill ABBA here?
Me.
Who hasn't threatened to kill their spouse before? That which they love very much?
I put my hand down.
I'm married to Jesus. He's already dead.
Yeah, and I crucified him.
We have Pontius Pilate joining us on the call tonight.
Oh, I'm glad.
Anyway, are we going to get onto the music or what?
Yes, please.
You guys are riffing. Yeah. All right, GS, tell us about your song. Tell us about your goddamn song.
So today I'm bringing the opener from Mula, Woe Ye Demon Possessed, which came out in 74. The album cover is exactly what you would expect, a dollar bill with all the occult iconography you find on it. It's, I would consider it American krautrock, which technically isn't a thing, but it has a lot of the similar experimental attitude and ideals that you would find in krautrock. And it's not like the krautrock bands at the time, you know, had any idea what each other were doing. It sort of emerged spontaneously. So I think it's, you know, fair game. This is a duo who got a record out somehow. When you listen, you'll find it's not very, you know, commercially viable for 74. But it made its way out somehow and into our hands here today. I don't think there's a great deal more I have to say about it. It's a fun little ditty. Fun little ditty. You'll experience it. You'll enjoy it. Thank you. So that was Crystal Waters from Moolah's 1974 album, Woe Ye Demon Possessed. It's tinkly. It's textural. It does not have a chorus. What did you think, Fishy?
I thought it sounded like all the video game console start screen music jammed together. It was not my jam. I could not find a through line to, like, connect. It was just kind of, I don't know, it just was not coherent enough for me.
Can we have someone do the GameCube sound real quick with perfect recreation sound?
It's an interesting, it's a trio piece for piano, drums, and my aunt's wind chimes.
So they recorded on your front porch.
Yeah, there you go. Exactly.
How do I refer to you for the... How do we refer to you?
Princeton? Yeah, Princeton's fine.
All right. Since you have opinions on it, Princeton, what do you think?
Sure. It was good. It's an interesting thing. First of all, there was a little bit of a melody, melodic line that they kind of, like, pattern that kept going through. If I had to guess, it actually was pentatonic minor, I want to say. It happens to be the same opening notes from one of the coincidental, of course the same in the 70s, from Nightmare Before Christmas, which I remember it. Da 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 dum. So that's a melodic pentatonic. Unless I'm mistaken, am I wrong?
Well, given how, you know, so much music is scalar and also minor, it's it probably crops up all over the place. Like BSI Ray.
Oh yeah, that's true. Very much so. On the one hand, it's interesting how it contrasts with a lot of prog stuff. You hear a lot of, you know, Dream Theater, you know, Court of the Crimson King, and all that kind of stuff. And a lot of those pieces are, let's make something, you know, arrhythmic, slightly atonal, and those pieces are often a big old, we're going to show off how good we are. Let's go to shred this. We're going to, you know, go into 18 different keys, la 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 la. This one, by contrast, didn't. So on the one hand, it doesn't show off a whole lot of what the musicians and artists can do, but at the same time, it felt very peaceful. It didn't feel like it was a show-off piece. It felt like it was just ambiance. The total all piece all together was the more important part than showing off your artistry. And I kind of like that. It's a nice contrast.
Yeah, and the production has at least as much to say as musicianship in a lot of genres of music. But I think King Crimson is an interesting one to mention there, because they definitely did some more, you know, ambient textural pieces as well as their fireworks show-off pieces. Even on their first album, they have a long stretch that people have referred to as just the clanking of pots and pans. So, Billy, your take. Oh, sorry.
I was going to say, but I can see why it's a good opener, because this feels like an overture.
Yes, Billy, your take.
I definitely agree. I like the string of... it felt like random noises, like, kind of pitching in and coming in every couple of seconds, you know, with the Princeton, you were joking about the cowbell, but it really was just like, I felt like I was in a dreamlike state, and all these noises just kind of kept flowing over me from out of nowhere. And it was interesting how, like, in a dreamlike state, you become aware of things after they've already been there. And I liked hearing those drums just, like, kicking in out of nowhere. And the drums were done very well. I definitely think the instruments that I was hearing, like, as they were coming in, it was all flowing together very well. I don't want this to sound bad, but I was kind of like falling asleep to it, because it was just the way it was kind of melodically all coming together inside my head, and I was spacing out. But it definitely felt like an artistic collusion of like my brain and the music all together, if that makes sense.
It makes you trip balls in your head. Okay, Les, did you trip balls in your head?
He's still tripping balls in his head.
Yeah, I keep seeing these whirling textures, and they're singing to me and telling me the recipe for tomato soup simultaneously. No, I really enjoyed that track. It did have a lot of ambient pulsing that might be perceived as boring by some, but I did really enjoy the interjection of the rhythmic sections of drums, you know, just like crescendoing and decrescendoing like throughout. It really felt like, to me, it reminded me of like a train going down train tracks. And so it's an interesting juxtaposition with the wind chimes. You know, it feels like, you know, you're out in the country, you know, you're out on your front porch and there's a train that passes through your front yard every day and you're just kind of vibing. So it felt very comforting to me in that regard.
That's interesting. It has a lot more of a claustrophobic, cavernous feel to me, but you are in the open fields by the railroad track. Yeah. I guess that's a wrap for that one. Let's move on.
Okay, fair enough. Move on.
Yeah, fuck your train.
Choo-choo.
More cowbell.
I've got a fever, and the only cure is the next song, please.
Yeah, let's carry us all away to the next song.
All right, that was a good track. Next up, we will have... how do I pad this out until I can find... what's your middle name? Okay,
Jennifer.
Jennifer. Billy Jennifer Lopez. That's your
thought. We had the fish next.
Yeah, Fishy.
Oh, was I next?
Yeah, you flop onto the stage.
Alrighty, my bad. Sorry. I'm going to use Tommy Tate for the Dollar Bill for my first song. I don't know very much about his discography in general. I do know that it was sampled in a song called Book of Rhymes by Knots in 2002. And I can kind of see why. I think you will be too able to see why a rap song might sample it after. So this is Tommy Tate for the Dollar Bill, 1981.
They will not.
Okay, that was Tommy Tate for the dollar bill. Since you're going to hate it, GS, what did you think first?
Oh, it was only the intro that I hated. And the thing that I hated about it is the sped up vocals. For some reason, those are, you know, anathema to me. I can't stand them. One of my big musical pet peeves. And I know that's just a subjective thing. Otherwise, I thought the track was nice and interesting. It was smooth and funky, and the vocals were soulful in that, you know, ostentatious Mosma-filled style. But the vocalist pulled it off, and I think the performance, the vocal performance, is really the draw, the appeal for this track. The intro, I thought, was kind of funny. It sounded like they just had a bunch of keyboards lying around in the studio, and they thought, well, while we're here, we might as well use them, get them on the track. the overall arrangement, though, was a lot more... subdued. It sounded like it had a lot of disco style to it, with the occasional strings, the backing vocals, and that little, you know, eighth note trill and run that they did now and then was very disco indeed. But it seemed almost like it was a bridge between the late 70s and the early 80s, like the new wave with the that guitar sound. And and structurally, it had more in common with, you know, what I associate with the 80s music, where you've got that eternal present of the looping chords that don't really go anywhere different. And then you just have, you know, different arrangement interjections over top of that, and a vibe that just persists for a while. And it is one of those songs that is mostly chorus, except for, you know, the little bridge and the fills in that intro. Overall, I thought it was nice. I wouldn't mind coming on the radio now and then, except for that intro. But, you know, I know that is just a personal issue.
Yeah, and that's fair. I know a lot of people that'll totally disregard anything if it has any amount of sped up vocals. So that's definitely a fair take. What did you think, Princeton?
He beat me all to it, including the 70s, 80s rich stuff. No, it's really good. A lot of heart, a lot of soul. A little repetitive. I don't know if it needed to be, you know, maybe a more contrasting B section if I had to redo it, but I can totally see why it's very good sampling. It's got an amazing bass line. It's, you know, for the dollar bill can easily be construed for other connotations outside of different contexts. Got a good beat. You can dance to it.
Cool. What did you think, Billy?
Yeah, I definitely I enjoyed it. I think it went on, this has already been said, but it went on a little too long for my taste. I enjoyed the intro a good bit. I might have actually preferred if the intro was a little bit more like what we would get throughout the song, just because I told you I got hit by a car, so my music tastes are a little bit weird now because of that. So I think that would have that it was still really funky. I loved the bass. It was enjoyable, but I did just I would have liked to see a little bit more variance in the bridge and everything instead of just being all mostly just the chorus over and over again.
Yeah, I can definitely get the opinion that it does kind of go on a bit. And last not least, what did you think, Laz?
Oh, well, I quite enjoyed it. I did think the intro was a little bit shitposty and it didn't really need it. But other than that, I'm totally fine with, a funky soul song just being entirely chorus. I like both styles. I like the chorus centric ones, and I also like the 8 minute long ones that are wanky with four guitar solos. So I'm fine with with either gender, if you will, of the funky bunch.
Yeah. All right, that was Tommy Tate for the dollar bill.
I believe Princeton is next.
All right there, so I'll go ahead and start with my first one here. And so most of my expertise, not all of it, but one of the things that kind of been in the last few years is Gothabilly, which is kind of has influences of surfer rock and ska and rockabilly and punk and although the punk is more psychobilly, this is one that's a little bit more closer to just surfer ska, but kind of fun. It's called Surfer Girl by Homegrown. Hope you enjoy.
Next to me, play. soft old lonely tune on a ukulele. I don't know what had happened, but I'd fallen asleep. The next morning I woke up, she was sleeping next to me.
That was Surfer Girl by Homegrown. Any thoughts or opinions?
Call someone specific.
Okay. Well, considering it was sea related, let's go with Fishy.
I feel like I could have liked this song if it was two different songs. Really don't like that kind of whiny surfer boy kind of lilt at the end of every sentence in my fast music, especially because this was kind of punky, you know, and when he sings it, it kind of sounded more whiny than punky to me. So not my favorite, but it did have some really nice instrumentals, especially towards the beginning, I think.
Speaking of which, GS was mentioning something in the chat about the instrumentals, that you had something about compression, if you mind breaking that down a little.
Oh, no, that was a meta. That was just about, you know, the version of the track we were hearing rather than anything to do with the music itself.
Oh, okay. My bad. My apologies. No, that's her. That's her. Yes, it is a bit pop punk in that sense. I think GS also mentioned as well. Any other thoughts, Laz?
Oh, were you moving on to someone else?
I guess I'm new here. I don't know what I'm doing.
I'm sure GS has more thoughts.
I surely do.
We don't have to hear them.
Also reasonable.
No, you can go.
Okay, I'll share the rest of my thoughts. Well, to me, it sounded a bit like pop punk that wanted to be Santana. The guitarist is clearly the band leader based on all the soloing. The vocals did sound a bit like a fuckboy to me, which is, I think, what Fishy was trying to articulate. But I like the arrangement a lot. The drums are very snappy. There was a nice crack on the snare and big fat toms. So clearly, they were working with a good producer on that. And the bassist wasn't falling asleep, but he wasn't overplaying either, and he had a good timbre. So, yeah, props to the actual arrangement of the band on that one. I don't know. I'm not a big fan of this genre in general, but I think the band was having fun with it, and I can hear that. And the funny surf chord at the end did tickle me a little. I appreciate when bands do things like that. That shows that they're maybe not taking it too seriously.
Yeah, or note playing to the roots. No, thank you. No, I agree. I just thought I'd share that. Who's next?
Whoever you want.
Well, I guess you originally called me to go next, so I still will, unless you want to hear from someone else first.
Oh, I was about your opinion, but no, that's fine. Yeah, let's have you go next.
Okay.
Do it last. Do it.
Well, I guess I am one of two people here that unironically listens to pop punk, so I can't poo-poo on that specifically anyway. But yeah, no, this was a fun track, and I'm not gonna break any new ground here by saying that I did also like the arrangement. I thought it was really well executed, and the vocals didn't really bother me at all. They were just, they were there to serve one specific function, one note function, and they certainly did that. We definitely got a good feel for the tone and the genre they were going for, and it was well executed. It was a fun, simple song. I'm fine with it. It's I don't know that this is a phrase that gets thrown around on this podcast a lot, but I guess I'll go ahead and say it anyway. I don't know if I would seek it out, but just like hearing it in the wild, it's fun.
Okay, who's next?
I guess I'm concluding for our thoughts. This is Billy, by the way. So I think I might be on the other end of the spectrum from others here. I enjoyed this one a lot. I've been listening to a little bit more of the pop punky things that I listened to when I was in high school, just because I do have the nostalgia for it, and I do enjoy coming back to Taking Back Sunday every now and then. This is definitely not that same feel exactly, but I do love the pop punk vibes. I love the mashup of this. It's very fun. It's very jaunty. I loved it when he increased his intensity, and he's just getting outraged, and you can tell they were all having a good time making this track, and that's what it's all about for this kind of song to me, that they're having fun, and that energy is just so contagious. So I definitely would seek this kind of thing out personally. It's just such a fun track. And that pop punk vibe, it's so catchy. I can't get enough of that kind of thing.
You and me, Billy, we'll grab our trilby hats and our checkered pants, and we'll hit the town this weekend.
That sounds great.
So these people had to have a good time.
Count me out.
Yeah, you can't teach GS how to have a good time.
Is that a whole nother podcast? This entire song is just to make GS smile.
Trust me, I'm here to make GS frown.
Fair enough. It's interesting you mentioned that a lot of you guys mentioned the levels. This is actually the second recording of it. The first recording is a little bit more one note. I like this one has the highs and lows and kind of more tells a story dynamically, which can be a turnout for some, but I like it. So, yeah, thanks for your time. All right. And what song is up next?
You can introduce me. Sorry.
Next up in our lineup is a man. You know him. You've seen him under the riverbed. You've been looking for him under the riverbed. Here he is. Billy, the man himself, presenting his next song.
I'm coming out from under the riverbed. My song I'm playing for you today, this is by Matthew Lee Cothran. I don't know if I said that correctly, but he's a songwriter who lives in Asheville, North Carolina. He's made music. If you're a lo-fi indie fan, you might know of Coma Cinema or Elvis Depressedly. He lives in GS's ass also. He makes real sad boy music. I'm really anticipating that no one's going to like this, and I'm really ready for it. This does get a little chorus heavy, but I really like the feel of the song. It feels very sad boy, teenage, just getting out of high school, and you had a bad day, but you know you get to go play Xbox at the end of the day. Without further ado, this is Cherry High by Matthew Lee Cothran. Cherry High by Matthew Lee Cothran. I definitely love the synths in that one. And I like his high voice contrasting those synths. Let's hear what people have to say. I think we haven't heard Blaz's opinion go first, so let's hear what you have to say. Laz.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. You got me. You're gonna have me. I quite enjoyed that, and I feel like you only singled me out because I said in the comments that I was enjoying it. But it's funny because if you didn't point out that those were synths, I could have been like convinced that it was just you know, like a bass or a guitar that had like the gain turned up all the way with a little bit of crunchiness thrown in there. But not that that's a bad thing. Certainly makes it a little more ambiguous, a little more interesting. There's a little bit of mystery there. I not that I necessarily seek out mystery in my lo-fi indie rock. Although that sounds like a good pickup line, I think. But maybe not a good one, but one that might work once in an odd spot somewhere in the country, and that spot changes every other week. But overall, I enjoyed the track. I thought it was definitely maybe a little one note, but I think that's sort of the trend tonight that I'm okay with, the unintentional theme of simple songs with a simple progression, you know, that seems to have been the vibe that most people are going for tonight. And if that is the case, everyone's going to be very disappointed with my with my second track.
Yeah, good thoughts there. A little meandering about the dating stuff, but I definitely understand and agree. I think it is one note, and I am okay with that too. Princeton, let's hear what you have to say.
It's interesting that's called Cherry High, because if I had to describe the song to somebody who's never heard it, I'd say give The Cure the job of doing a style parody of Strawberry Hill. And I wonder if the fruit play is intentional or unintentional, because it feels a very Strawberry Fields Forever, with a little bit of 80s Cure sad boy sensibilities. But maybe I'm wrong.
I really couldn't tell you otherwise.
And I think we were talking about in the chat before that the first lyric that kind of jumped at me is like, oh, it's high school stuff, sad, guts of bird. I'm like, what? And then it took me a time, and some other people reminded me that that's what's it called? A divination thing. Auspices, haruspex, reading the guts of birds to see the future, that kind of thing. So it's an interesting, the artist is playing with some fun imagery there that you wouldn't necessarily expect. Not just pure random, trippy Strawberry Fields stuff, not Friday I'm in Love, The Cure stuff. They're kind of going a little bit beyond, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, I was looking at the lyrics, just kind of gathering my thoughts. There's a lot of religious imagery here, a lot of stuff talking about the revelation. Abaddon twists your life, your forehead bears the sign. It's a lot of kind of life ending stuff. Let me be your wife, a cop car parked in the drive. It feels very much like, and this might just be the vibe I'm getting, just because I'm picturing that kind of like teenage scenario, but it just traumatized like kid just feeling like his life is pretty much over, and that like religious imagery popping up in his head.
And one last thing I would mention is that this sounds like this feels like something that would go an amazing movie soundtrack. I know it's, I don't want to diminish it, but it sounds like this is the perfect thing to play in the background of a good key scene.
Oh yeah, definitely agreed. What's your thoughts, Fishy?
Well, you said you didn't expect anyone to like it, but I'm not going to be the first one to say I didn't like it. I thought it was pretty good, like everyone else has said. you know, it was simple, but it's the kind of song that, you know, probably needs to be simple because it feels a lot more emotional than technical. Like, he just wanted to get some stuff out on record, and I can appreciate that. And I think he did it pretty well. And like Princeton said, he certainly chose some interesting imagery in the lyrics to go with the music. Princeton, sorry, not Preston.
No worries. I forget my own name if it's not written in my underwear.
Nice. I am actually surprised. I thought this would be a little bit more controversial just because of his singing, especially. But it is good to hear that you guys, at the very least, enjoyed it. All right, kicking off, concluding with GS. What were your thoughts?
Yeah, I don't know that there's too much controversial to, you know, really get out of this one. Seems pretty accessible, generally enjoyable to me. I liked the guitar timbre a lot. That was the first thing I noticed. Then the pulsating synth bass came in, and I thought that was neat too. And then there was the more expressive sort of synth pads that came in, and I also enjoyed those. On the topic of arrangement, I thought the tambourines were interesting. I thought that might have been like a musical allusion to like old R&B or bubblegum pop. A lot of music like this is nostalgic for other times, so you can get the 80s out of the synths and maybe like the, you know, 60s, 70s out of the tambourine. The production does once again prove that reverb is the sad boy's best friend. The tambourines, I thought it was funny. I remembered partway through that Genesis once mentioned that having tambourine in their chorus was something of a cliche for them. And then the tambourine coming in during the eternal chorus that comprises this song seemed to be a funny parallel. I'm not really a lyrics person, so when people started pointing out the lyrical content, I thought, you know, what could be more edgy than a high schooler? So a lot of this imagery and a lot of the, you know, themes do make sense in that context. High school angst tends to have one wanting there to be something more to life. You want to be a teenage scumbag so bad, but you're just suburban. And, you know, the yearning for any flavor, any character, any color to manifest is something that I think might be captured in this song more than an actual reflection of anyone's life being in peril at all. But overall, I did like the song musically, and I enjoyed it. I might even look up the artist.
Yeah, great to hear. Like, I don't know if you would like the Coma Cinema or Elvis Depressedly, but I definitely think his solo stuff is worth listening to. I definitely enjoy his albums, Condemned to Die in a Carolina Motel Bar, and My First Love, Mends My Final Days. Those are two great albums.
Okay, great. Yeah, it was a good pick, good song. I thought it was good that Billy was so confident about the song that he managed to work in a criticism of my criticism into his presentation. Very good. So last up for round one, I'm going to present a song by Ana Frango Elétrico. I am definitely butchering that. A Brazilian singer-songwriter uses they/them pronouns. I'm not sure that'll be relevant, but I, you know, throw it out there. Why not? And this is a song from their sophomore album. They're called Little Electric. The album is called Little Electric Chicken Heart. The song is called Saudade, which is a Portuguese word roughly translating to bittersweet. So yeah, let's listen to that and get some opinions. Let's stoke the fires. Thank you. All right, that was Saudade by Anna Franco Electrico, and I'm not satisfied with my definition of Saudade. It's I'm going to go to Wikipedia, which may or may not be correct. It is a deep emotional state of nostalgic or profound melancholic longing for something or someone one cares for or loves. Moreover, it often carries a repressed knowledge that the object of longing may never be had again. All right, and
that's a little more complex than the original one.
Yes. Yeah, I wanted to be a little bit more thorough because it... Yeah. Okay, so I am curious to see what Billy thought of this.
It was... As Peach Hunk said to me, it was very Breakfast at Tiffany's. It had a very nice like Manhattan vibe to it. Walking into a movie, and you know, it's one of those scenes where everybody's like looking at things in awe, and the soundtrack's going to them, you know, walking around like, wow, this is Manhattan, I can't believe we're in Manhattan, and they're looking at the skyscrapers and everything, and they have heartbreak in the next scene after that and stuff. I liked the vibe of it. I don't know how much I thought it was technically well done. And I liked the vocals, the background vocals. It all kind of it all connected with me in that visual element, but I'm not sure how much I would really come back to this track. I enjoyed it on that level, but just you know, wasn't doing much more for me than that.
So it probably wouldn't be like an artist that you'd revisit or anything?
Unfortunately not.
Okay. Princeton, what did you think?
I liked it. I meant to mention in the chat, it reminds me a lot of the background vocals, reminds me of Manhattan Transfer, you know, that acapella, mostly acapella group that did all those things, soundtracks in the late 60s, you know, remind me, even that's in the same vein. The artist did a great job of recapturing that exact, you know, old classic retro feel. The interesting thing to me is that it felt like it had a really good build up, and by the time they got to it, they almost immediately had like just 30 seconds of the actual lead vocalist and then just ended. While it didn't seem to go much overall in the whole piece, it kind of still left you wanting more. So I actually really enjoy that. This is kind of a thing that I would listen to if I'm in the right mood. I would listen to, you know, 2-3 albums of this kind of stuff, and the next day I'd be completely sick of it and not want to hear it for a month. So it's you have to be in the mood for it, but this is right up my alley.
Interesting. I guess we have a similar approach to music then.
Listen to something and wring out all the possible joy of it before you get tired of it.
Yeah, and then maybe revisit it again in 7 years and be like, oh yeah, I liked this.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, GS, what'd you think?
Well, to me, it sounded almost like a big sonic collage. Like, all of the arrangement had been drawn from disparate places and then assembled. Especially in the intro. The intro didn't have a clear identity at all to me. I thought it might be an overture because there was so much different stuff going on in it. Like there was some maybe more classical piano and there was some jazzy electric piano. And I think that might have been, you know, a reference to the more bossa stuff that comes in after. The record static, I don't know what that was supposed to be for. It was there so briefly. Usually that's... shows up when someone wants to evoke something nostalgic or lo-fi, and knowing the definition of the word, that makes a little more sense, but it really doesn't linger long enough to leave enough of an impression, really. And further than nostalgia, there was a lot of 60s elements and the arrangement and the textures. If I'm wrong, and it was all originally composed, then I thought the horns had a sort of more Berkeley sound. I don't know. It didn't really make sense to me as a track. It didn't seem to click. Maybe it makes more sense if you are from the culture that it borrows from, but it didn't really do anything for me.
This is a historic moment, ladies and gentlemen. This is when the real GS comes out. And from now on, he's going to hate every song. No, I'm kidding.
I only hate your songs. This is well established.
That's not true. You like some of my songs.
Hey, I'm surprised he enjoyed my song. I really thought he was going to hate it.
it was a good song. Fishy.
Well, like Princeton said, I thought it ended right when I was really getting excited for what was going to come next. But I do think that I definitely enjoyed the entirety of it more than GS seemed to. But I do get where he was coming from with it seeming kind of scattershot. For the first 5-10 seconds, I was certain it was going to be a hip-hop song. But, I don't speak Portuguese, so I'll take your Wikipedia definition of saudade, but I can definitely, feel the bittersweetness, as you said. And one second, sorry, I got a cough. Oh, and the kind of bittersweet, sad part of it, it's really interestingly with the instrumentals, because I'm used to hearing that style of music and those instruments employed almost exclusively in purely instrumental tracks, and by themselves they tend to sound naturally upbeat, at least to me. So to hear someone singing happy sounding then kind of trailing off at the end of every sentence to a more wistful feeling juxtaposed with those instruments and that style, I thought that was really neat to listen to.
Okay, yeah. I feel like, it was kind of the point that it does seem like to draw upon like many inspirations from all sorts of places. It definitely feels like a pastiche, but I like that about it. I thought it was a pretty fun little track, and it has gotten stuck in my head off and on for the last week, and that's why I decided to bring it tonight.
Yeah, so, I imagine. So
I can inflict it on others. All right, cool. Moving on to our friend GS has another song for us.
Sigh of exasperation.
What was that?
That was just fucking awesome.
Well, I have something a little bit more upbeat now. It's actually a Canadian band represent. The working name stuck, so they wound up being called Martha and the Muffins.
That was a great name.
Well, some people may disagree, but any band, if they're successful, no matter how idiosyncratic, will spawn some imitators, and this band is proof of that. I think this album is pretty unambiguously influenced by the Talking Heads, their Eno years especially. You'll hear the groovy bass and the honestly pretty impressive Fripp clone on guitar. And some tracks even have a really good David Byrne impersonator, both lyrically and vocally. This one has some, different stuff going on in the structure, but I think it has a good energy throughout. Hope you enjoy. Now, what is it?
It's funny. I used to be a David Byrne impersonator at parties. I don't know why at the birthday parties. It never caught on.
Yes. So here from Martha and the Muffins, known internationally as M plus M, is Several Styles of Blonde Girls Dancing.
tearing apart at the seams. Your gesture is knocking a hole in the air. You perceive me, you perceive me, you retrieve me, you retrieve me.
Definitely going to bring something by the Muffins for a future episode.
I love the Muffins.
Okay.
Talk amongst yourselves. Martha and the Muffins is neither Moth and nor Muffin.
Martha gets shot.
Why did you say that name?
Martha.
Oh, this was, we were supposed to be listening to Martha and the Muffins. I listened to Martha and the Vandellas instead. Damn.
Anyway. So from their 83 album.
I was just eating a muffin.
Dance Park. Martha. That was Martha and the Muffins with several styles of blonde girls dancing. You don't hear the eponymous Martha very much, and you don't hear the frippiness that the guitarist is capable of, but I think it's an enjoyable track nonetheless. Would you agree, Princeton?
I really liked it. I think this is probably the one I've enjoyed the most so far, no offense to everybody else, except for the ones I brought myself. No, I really like this. I was toe-tapping too.
Interesting.
I can see what you mean about the Talking Heads influence. There's a little, I'd say, Bowie in there too. You know, 10% dash of Bowie in there too. When he started singing about coming up from the underground, I immediately heard "Underground" from Labyrinth. That's just me. I think there's almost something a little ironic with the title Several Styles of Blonde Girls Dancing, which might have some reference to something or other, I don't know. But later on, they kind of do this kind of like rhythm breakdown, and it feels like your typical 70s, 80s songs of here's a bunch of white guys breaking it down in the style of some other culture's, you know, rhythm section. But the fact that it's called Blonde Girls Dancing almost makes me feel like it's almost a self-parody, but maybe I'm looking into it too much.
Oh yeah, I think they were definitely taking the piss to an extent, and bringing in, you know, elements of world music is something that white musicians have been doing to various levels of success, you know, for a long, long time. What did you think, Laz?
Well, other than blatant crony capitalism, there's nothing more 80s than cultural appropriation.
And new Coke.
Well, Coke in general.
And new I think that falls under the capitalism. I quite enjoy the song. I thought it was definitely there was a lot of subtext to that song that I really appreciated. That, you know, like, it can be appreciated on the surface level of just a really fun, groovy pop song, but also it felt like there was like something sinister lurking beneath it. And
very Talking Heads, yes.
I don't really. Yeah, absolutely. And I also got like little hints of Bowie, especially from the vocal delivery, as Princeton pointed out. Overall, yeah, this was a good pick, and very, very good.
Yeah, Billy, did it thrill you? Did you dance to it? Did you undulate?
You didn't see me dancing? I turned on my video.
I did. That was a prompt.
Okay. I don't understand prompts. But I thought it was pretty much like perfect, if not like near perfect. I really enjoyed this one. Had a lot of fun. I thought that the vocals definitely were like that style that I'm really enjoy, like Talking head style. I actually kind of missed you saying that, and then I was like, this really does sound like that, and then you said it again, and I was like, oh yeah, that was cool. And I really liked all the, everything flowed together so perfectly. All the instruments were just like, so it was so funky, and there's so many harmonies, and I enjoyed that. I could see this being sung differently, but I think the way that it was approached as a song elevated the song to a different, like, instead of just being, you know, instead of just sounding like a 80s song or something, it was more than that, especially with the singing and everything. I liked the sinister elements. I thought it was a great closing way of doing it. You know, you'd expect it to just end at full throttle, but I like how they slowed everything down and it just ended the way it did. My favorite part was that intro of just all of the instruments coming at full throttle and the way it just, it was so good. I liked it when it got reincorporated. I was kind of hoping that they would do vocals over top of it or like have that reintroduced with maybe vocals, but I mean, that's the only thing I could complain about. It was really great.
Yeah, I think emulating the Talking Heads is a tall order, and I think they pulled it off, especially in terms of the, you know, groovy arrangements. What did you think, Fishy? Did it leave you floppy?
Oh, I'm just flopping. No, I liked it, but I don't think I liked it as much as everybody else. For me, it called to mind so many different bands, you know, like, especially of the time. Like you said, obviously the Talking Heads and like others have said Bowie, but to the point that it kind of, I don't know, it felt more like a collaboration album with a bunch of different people playing different parts as opposed to a coherent single piece to me. Like I kept finding little parts that I was getting really into and then it'd be something completely different. And that's, you know, that's fine. But I think if I wanted to listen to this style of thing, I think I'd just listen to the Talking Heads.
But what about when you've run out of their discography and you want more?
Then I ask you for a recommendation.
I definitely think even though it's reminiscent of that of Talking Heads, I see it as its own thing for sure. I enjoyed it as its own entity.
Other songs do have maybe more of a unique style, especially when Martha is taking the microphone. But yeah.
Yeah, she was too busy getting shot in an alley in this one.
If I may say one more thing, if I could. It's interesting that Billy mentioned that it sounds like it has elements of a normal 80s song, but I gotta add some more. Is actually only at the end when you mentioned this is 1983 that I didn't realize that this is an actual 80s song. I assumed it was an homage that was stealing elements and adding more modern sensibilities and more modern, you know, tricks and twists onto it. I didn't even occur that.
Yeah, I think the guitar intro in particular sounds a lot more modern than the rest of the song, like maybe something out of the mid-2000s even. What's our next song sound like?
I guess I jaded you by bringing Saudade. So now you expect everything to be postmodern now. Oh, man. Who's next? It's Fishy.
My next song's going to be, and I'm only pretty sure about these pronunciations. It is a Russian band, but Pompeia Chinese. This was released as a single, I think, in 2010, and then came out on their album Tropical in 2011. And it's very neat. It has a lot of new wave elements, I think, and it's one of my favorite genres. So, Pompeia Chinese.
If you showed me the original Cyrillic, I could pronounce it, but it doesn't really matter that much.
Do not fist the androids.
Drifting in the sky.
Okay, that was Pompeia Chinese. What did you think, Billy?
This isn't Vampire Weekend. I really liked it. It was just that kind of style. I'm a big sucker also for people singing over each other. Those two voices going at once. I was a big sucker for that that bass just strumming in the background. Very funky, good tune. Would listen again. Would be interested in following this artist for sure.
I already did.
Same.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool.
Me three?
What did you think, Laz, if you've already followed him before?
Yeah, man, Billy said all the good stuff. I wish he'd say some for me. I really enjoyed this song. It was it was great. It was textural. It gave me that nice feeling of like being a kid laying in the back seat of a car and just watching the headlights pass overhead on the highway. Just sort of really mellow, but also at the same time it was energetic enough. It was snappy. It definitely kept me engaged. I was really vibing to it, and I really did appreciate the silky synths in the background and the way they trailed off a bit and then reemerged. It gave the song a very lived-in feel. You know, it doesn't, like, there's a lot of, I don't want to get on my soapbox, but there's a lot of like pop music that just feels like manufactured and just like soulless and just like prepackaged in 10 minutes in a studio with a bunch of people doing coke and not giving a shit. But this really felt you know, engaging and inspired. And I guess I could have also said that about the track that GS brought, but I chose to say it about this one. So take it as a
compliment. Alrighty, I will. What did you think, GS?
Well, overall, I liked it. It had a nice vibe to it. At first, the instrumentation seemed like it was going to be more post-punk with the style of the guitar and the big saturated crunchy bass. I thought I was going to hate the vocals for a while. They seemed really, really indie pop, you know, that disaffected sort of vibe. But although I didn't like the verses, the songwriting won me over by the chorus, and I found the chorus arrangement quite compelling. And then after that, you know, I didn't mind the song at all, and in fact, I quite enjoyed it. I think this is either, you know, sitting in the back of your parents' car watching the lights go by, or cruising with the top down in, you know, a neon-speckled sunset core, as opposed to the dark wave gloom that I expect from, you know, what I saw coming when I heard the instrumentation at the beginning and knowing this was a Russian group. But yeah, it did feel, as others said, sort of lived in, like there was an actual, you know, human behind the production and the arrangement. And I can definitely see, you know, not personally, but why others would, you know, seek out the artist after hearing this track.
Yeah, well, I'm glad that the bot played the version it did then, because a lot of what's been said so far isn't too much present in the other version of this song, which has way less going on. It's a lot, I think it's even completely just a solo. I think there's only one singer on it, but I'm not sure. And it's a lot slower, so I'm glad the bot picked this one. What did you think, Princeton?
I just want to start by out of the gate, but to say for Laz, don't knock, you know, recording studios filled with coke-filled artists. Otherwise, we wouldn't get, you know, Fleetwood Mac rumors. I'm just saying.
Oh, no, in theory, I have nothing against the
practice. When it's the executives rather than the musicians who are doing all the coke.
Oh, that's a whole different story. Of course. Right. My apologies. That's,
yeah, that was my intent. Yeah.
Oh, no. No, I mean, the best stuff's already been said. We've had a lot of really good funky bass lines tonight. Maybe I'm crazy. This is one good one more for the list. That's mostly all I got. I got notes of a little bit of your classic, you know, indies, but also some let's see, some of the other things that try to remind me of. A little bit of Blur, a little bit of Better Than Ezra's instrumental stuff.
I think you're crazy.
Or I'm just not as versed as indie as you guys are. That's entirely possible.
No, I was just saying that because you said maybe I'm crazy.
Oh, then you're correct. Thank you for, you know, I should have said call me crazy. Then you could say you're crazy and I'd say thank you. But now it's just out of sequence and just feels awkward.
This isn't Vampire Weekend.
I paid for a full weekend of this vampire.
It's hard to find a good suck these days.
We can always just call you up.
You can always just call up your mom.
Utterance. Oh.
Please, she's so lonely.
You never call.
Princeton, you are up next. What do you got for us?
All right, well... I tried to give something kind of fun and different and other than the first song, and I was like, hey, let me give them this surfer whatever, and you guys are saying, well, it's pop punk. Well, guess what? I've got more pop punk, so
love it.
Chew on that. This is a group called Shoglen. I found them from a friend in college who lived down the dorm with me. He got it. He learned from them from Minnesota. It looks like they have not had any albums since. But I particularly liked that that first one they did, which is really good. This one's called Sometimes I Feel. The background behind it is that they, I think as a project for somebody else, did a soundtrack for a indie film or mini short film or something like that that was about like a year in the life. So this is kind of a almost a stream of consciousness punk pop punk song kind of being, you know, a year in the life, if that makes sense. So I hope you enjoy. Let's even get it to play. It is on YouTube too.
It's so funny.
That's any better.
I feel this is oh, where you should that. Be. Feels like there is one more out here who still needs to come down, and it feel like I could kill someone. I feel like I am in love, and I feel like I'm outside of my skin, and it feels like I'm
All right, that was Show Glenn with Sometimes I Feel. All right, who was first to go last time? I think it was Billy. Let's start with Laz this time.
I don't really remember, unless you start last time. Go. Very, sure. Very interesting track. I was expecting something else with the pop punk, but that's not a bad thing.
Well, I guess not punk. Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, I could definitely see those. I guess with the instruments, it kind of gave me a little bit of a shellac vibe at some points. I don't know if I'm remembering correctly. But I think I enjoyed the latter half a little bit more. It felt like a little bit more varied in the instrumentation. But I could definitely enjoy this one. I liked what it was going for. I liked the feel of the time period it's taking from. But at the same time, like I said with the first half not being as strong, I guess with that time period that I felt like it was taking from, those songs could get a little bit generic after just a little bit of a listen. But I definitely felt like the latter half wasn't as generic. It definitely felt pretty good in what it was going for.
Gotcha. Well said. Well said. Jess, how about you want to go next?
All right. Well, as others have predicted, I hated the vocals so much that they blocked out most other considerations. I did like what was going on in the, I wouldn't call it a chorus, but like the verse part two thing with the marching snare patterns. I sort of had the expectation that would reappear later on and repeat for a while as a buildup, but that didn't happen. I disliked the vocals in a way that made me think that it was Billy who brought this track, because this is, you know, the sort of thing that he would inflict on me.
I have something worse for you.
I don't have a lot of thoughts other than that.
Right after this.
Well, that's something to look forward to. All right. I think we just heard from Billy.
I exist to suffer.
Thank you. So, Fishy, I don't think we've heard from you yet, correct?
I liked it. No, not yet. I liked it quite a bit. I'm kind of the opposite of GS. The lyrics were really what made me kind of stay into it. I think Billy was kind of right on the money when he said, you know, the song itself in isolation probably wouldn't come across as too generic, but I've just heard too many similar instrumentals on the radio and such. But the lyrics, you know, with the instrumentals, I really expected the lyrics to be a lot harder and more screechy, but I thought they were some pretty decent singing, especially for what the instrumentals had gotten me mentally prepared for. So I liked it pretty good.
Hey, glad to hear. So the lyrics are some of my favorite parts, too. One of the lines that always drives me every single time is the suddenly bringing it down and saying almost sheepishly, "I feel like a left hand." It's such a weird phrase, but it feels universal to me.
I think I feel what most people would feel when that is said. I definitely get a certain kind of feeling from being compared to a left hand. You're there, but not too useful.
Last but absolutely not least, Laz, do you have any thoughts?
I use my left hand for masturbation.
Okay, you're a little useful.
I'm happy for you. I feel sad for your left hand.
Thoughts. All right, moving on.
All right, on that note, what's up next?
Are we just moving on? Okay, it's good to just move.
We're in the home stretch here. Let's bring it on home.
My song is gonna be this is by the Brave Little Abacus. This song's called Untitled. Oh, fuck. Sorry. Abacus. I never really knew how to say it. This is, I think this is a very interesting, like swirling of it's mostly math rock, but it's very experimental. Again, this is going to be a little post-hardcore. You know, that this kind of can really vary with, your interests. It appeals to me, but I can see this not appealing to a lot of people. It can be a very self-indulgent genre, but I think that this sound is perfect. I'm very interested to see what you guys think. I think it's a very interesting molding of, melding of lots of different instruments all coming together. And his voice, again, it's going to be vocals for me that I really enjoy. These vocals are on the emo side. He's a whiner. And I see that really deterring people from listening to this. But let's get to it. Let's see GS hear this this whiner.
Sure that we're
All right, that was the brave little Abacus. Did I say it right again? Abacus.
Abacus.
That was untitled.
Well, that was a song.
Unfortunately, that whole album, I feel, is one of those albums that you really need to listen like together to be. It's a very cohesive album. Each track goes from one track to the next. So I couldn't really find a track that was as like solid like to listen to alone as much of that track. That track was the best pick for it. But I would really recommend, if you did like that track, to listen to the whole album, because the whole album is really like a masterpiece, in my opinion. It's very, it has very solid instrumentations and very solid singing that goes with those instrumentations. I think it's a very unique album. Very interested to see what you guys thought about that. Let's go with GS.
Oh boy, everyone picks me first because they're so sure I've got a hot take.
I thought you didn't because you're hot last time, so we can go with you last. You want to go in?
I'm always in the first half, though, it seems like.
Yeah,
fuck. I don't care. I thought it was just funny.
Fishy, what did you think?
Oh, you wish.
Definitely the lyrics, especially the screaming, not my kind of thing. I thought the instrumentation was pretty cool, especially, you know, when the math music came in, like somebody said in the comments, that I was kind of losing me up until that point. The instrumentation, that is, the lyrics lost me right off, but I think it came back pretty all right. The ending, I guess that leads into a new song, kind of. You said
It goes to a low point there, and then the next song starts off with screaming and a high point again.
Yeah, sure. I won't hold it against it then if it's, you know, meant to go into something else. But the ending did throw me a little, just cutting. But it was all right. Not for me, I don't think.
Very fair. What do you think, Princeton?
No offense, it reminded me of bad karaoke. Or more accurately, it felt like a mashup to me, because I've listened to a lot of mashups. And I'm like, these are great music and great instruments. This is great singing. They don't go together. Obviously, in context of the album, it might mesh together and there might be something that you just kind of train yourself and get used to. But it felt so very disjunct. I almost had to stifle a laugh. Again, I'm sure it's great. I'm sure it's amazing. But it's just like that. It makes an impression. It's not a sleepy little thing you're going to forget.
No, I totally understand. And I mean, I could have probably come up with a better track for it. But again, I just felt like this was a better track to listen to on its own. But very, I can't disagree with other people's opinions.
There's a thing in music theater called the 11 o'clock number, which is something right before the end to pop everyone back awake. And I think we found this show's 11 o'clock number, because people are gonna listen to that and they're gonna be awake for the rest of this.
I'm glad I can wake everybody up. Good morning. Laz, what did you think?
Okay, well, I would like to differ from some of the opinions and say that I did like, I've been meaning to get into this band for a while. They've been on my list, and I'm a bit of a math rock nut. I'm a bit of an everything nut, but I do enjoy a bit of math rock now and then, as a comfort. It's a creature comfort. And this was a pretty good example of it. This was, from what I could tell, a good sample. It got me interested in the idea of listening to the whole album. And I mean, it's going to be hard to like tread the line sometimes between, you know, picking a song that showcases the band or picking a song that's, you know, representative of the album it's from, or, you know, like I struggle with that with that one song that I picked from Beck Xwash last show we did. So I mean, but in this case, I thought it had a great energy to it. As Princeton said, I felt like it was you know, chaotic and discordant enough that it was an interesting bit of music, but also the vocals were certainly more pop punk indicative, as many people mentioned. But yeah, I thought it was a fine track. I wouldn't be surprised to learn that there were better songs on the album.
Yeah. Though. All right. GS, what are your conclusive thoughts?
I really was not fond of the vocals when they were clean, which you probably saw coming, but I don't know. I don't mind screaming when anyone does it. I'd rather listen to that than a lot of clean vocals out there any day. Musically, I didn't really hear much that engaged me. It did sound like mathrock musicians playing like emo music, which did keep distracting me. The drummer especially seemed a little out of place on that. He seemed like someone you'd bring in for something where you listen to it for the angularity and the chops rather than for the more traditional songwriting. And, you know, it did give me something to listen to throughout. I do enjoy that style of drumming, but I don't know that it worked with the music so well. I did note that at one point I think I heard wind chimes, and that was sort of an interesting thematic callback to my track. There was a rhythmic change back to the verse a few minutes in that I did like in terms of the songwriting, but that was really the only thing that you know I noticed in terms of the song itself. Not something I am gonna seeking out, anything. Unfortunately.
I did really like the drums in particular about that track. So it is tough to hear that you didn't enjoy it, but that is okay. The drums, I think, just add to the discordant nature of it, and I definitely love how the drums go in tandem with everything else, but that is very fair.
Sorry to ask a plebeian question here. There's a term that Laz and GS mentioned. Was it, I couldn't quite hear what you said, mathrock? Mathrock? I'm not familiar with that one.
Mathrock, yeah.
Can you spell for our viewers at home? I'm sorry, I'm not catching it.
A mathematical rock music. Typified usually by a lot of angularity, a lot of stops and starts, spasmodic music, and by a lot of time signature diversity and time signature modulation.
Yeah, gotcha. I've heard it in the context of Prague.
Which I did not clock in this song.
I've heard it, it's used in like Prague songs, but never heard the term math rock. That's interesting. Thanks.
Yeah, it's sort of a mashup of Prague and indie rock. It draws inspiration from both. Yeah, and there's also angular melodies, counterpoint, dissonance. You know, it's...
A lot of aggression, a lot of dissonance, yeah.
So the question is...
Your Hella, your Dillinger escape
plan. Is it math rock and the fact that it's about a brave little abacus intentional?
Probably, yes.
I hate that. I didn't make that connection.
And one more tiny thing. Hopefully, I think Fishy was only... Was it Fishy or Billy? Sorry for this one. I'm sorry.
Billy.
Who brought the song? Billy. Do you... Maybe you know the band a little bit more and can explain this. The name of that song is Untitled, in parentheses, Continued.
Oh, no.
Is there an Untitled Part 1?
It's just... It's just a continuation of the.
They're just being quirky.
And I guess this one was untitled.
Gotcha. Portrait of the Artist and a Struggle of Man. Got it. Okay. Nude Descending a Staircase. Got it.
That was a good point, though, Princeton, about like defining the subgenre for audiences that might not be acquainted with it. I need to get better about that.
No, it's okay.
We're all pretty far down the music rabbit hole, I think.
We got
Oh, I did. I mentioned Hella and Dillinger Escape Plan.
Actually, Dillinger Escape Plan is mathcore, and we're not getting into that yet.
Oh, fuck off.
It's a different... No.
Well, the Wikipedia defines it using the examples of King Crimson and Rush.
No, that's, I think...
Defines what?
Wikipedia defines math rock as examples such as King Crimson and Rush.
No, it says it has roots in bands. Like it's
Sorry.
It's inspired by those. Yeah. Which makes.
Well, later King Crimson, maybe, like arguably. Like Thrak era.
But as far as strong examples of math rock, if the listeners were interested in getting into it, like there's Battles, Hella, as GS mentioned, or Don Caballero. Toe. Yeah. This Town Needs Guns.
What's the band? I don't want to see. Right, so I want to see the. I'm gonna seize the day.
That's more math core-ish.
That's right. That is
Fall of Troy.
See, you always know what I'm seeing.
Is it math core the new things they're trying to teach kids so that they're dividing differently?
It's basically this up to 11 and with metal thrown in. If you were really curious.
No, I was mostly just joking, but no. Well, that we'll save that for another episode.
Yeah, we'll get to it. We'll get to every subgenre.
I can't
Of everything.
This is just the math integument.
We're going to do some music concrete next.
Bring your TI-83 calculator.
Oh, boy.
Wait, I got to plug this into my calculator and see if it's good. That's an old math rock joke.
It was good, but then I carried the one.
All right, is everyone ready for my next track?
I masturbate with my left hand.
No, but hit us anyway.
Nice callbacks. Anyway, this will be our closer, and it is in compliance, but it is the longest song that I have brought to date. It's 10 minutes long. So let's get on that. This to close off the show, here is Opus by Black Country New Road. And I am cutting it close because this puts me at 14:30 and our cutoff is 15 minutes. You know, including my first song.
Thank you. Everybody's coming up. I guess I'm a little bit late to the party. Everybody's coming up. I guess I'm a little bit late to the party. Now everybody's coming up. I guess I should have had something else to say. And now everybody's coming up. What we built must fall.
All right, that was Opus, the closing track from Black Country New Road's debut album, which came out last year. I really enjoy the whole album. It's an experience. If you even remotely enjoyed that, I highly recommend it. And their new one. Actually, wait, am I an idiot? I might be an idiot. Hold on. No, I'm not an idiot in this regard anyway. Yeah, so I enjoyed that whole album. That the album is called For the First Time, fittingly enough. And their new album from this year is pretty good too. It's more like post-punky though. Okay, before I keep rambling, in my somnolent state, let's pass the baton on to Fishy. I haven't picked you first. Actually, I probably have. Maybe. I don't know.
It's cool. I really liked it. I thought it was, you know, a good thing to end on, and I'm definitely going to be checking out this band some more, but I can see why they called this track Opus. I mean, it really feels like they decided to show off on this one, and I think it paid off with all the, you know, variation and the instrumentation and the tempo. I really liked the instrumentals between the vocal verses. It felt like the instruments were chasing him to the next verse every time he stopped singing. And I think when he got there, the lyrics in his voice, the singing, you know, it really made it me feel like he felt like he was being chased too by the music. So Yeah, I think it rocked. It was a pretty good song to end this one on.
Okay, good. Princeton.
I like, I'll keep it brief. It reminded me style-wise, I haven't heard a lot of stuff like this, but it reminded me a little bit of Hot Hot Heat, kind of, and that's kind of general tone overall. It's interesting because the instrumentation, it reminded me a lot of klezmer music. Have you ever heard a lot of that?
Oh, sure.
So that struck me as very interesting. So I'm sure if I got a chance to sit and listen to this, you know, a dozen times, I'd find new things every single time. But yeah, it does feel a Bohemian Rhapsody, where it's a little tiny mini symphony in one single piece. It's actually, as Fishy said, a great closer piece. It's a perfect contrast to the overture that GS brought us at the beginning.
All right, well, speaking of GS,
oh, you're not going to say anything else? Okay. Yeah, I definitely was getting klezmer too, but maybe that's just the arrangement and the style of the clarinets in particular, rather than the rest of the band. That's definitely, you know, something that they were going for unambiguously.
I don't know if it was actually clarinets, although tenor sax trying to sound like a clarinet, but I could be wrong.
Maybe. Either way, it was definitely going for that idiom, and I think, you know, that was pretty unambiguous. But early on, I wasn't sure if it was going for more of a ska thing because of the also punk energy of the drums. The vocals, I had mixed feelings about. When they first came in, I thought it sounded like, I have so many feelings, and I'm feeling them so much, and it just seems sort of affected in that way. And then when he got a bit, a little later on, I thought they almost reminded me of the vocals in Shoo Shoo, briefly. And when the vocals started to get more aggressive, then once again, I was more hooked. Maybe I just have a thing for that form of more primal expression. The song itself seemed to be structured in sort of an art rock way rather than something like neo-prog, where it has a few relatively, you know, technically simple motifs that it refers to and brings back. Other than a couple of, you know, quicker passages that the woodwind players have probably had to practice a little bit for, it was surprisingly musically straightforward for something 10 minutes long and calling itself Opus. I did start getting interested when the clarinets were freaking out a little bit a few minutes in, but then the energy dropped right back to zero and the track lost me again. And I feel like I was trying to build tension and catharsis, but the tension mostly just left me cold. I don't want to say it was boring, but in the context of the rest of the track, I didn't think there was anything musically or emotionally to really draw me in. I think the clarinet arrangement and some of the, you know, more high energy vocals, more aggressive articulations were, all that was really going on. Although the time did fly by. You said this was 10 minutes long and it didn't entirely feel like it. I would have believed 7 minutes or something like that. So there's definitely something to be said for a song that manages that. I feel like this is something that might be more interesting in the context of the full album rather than as an individual track. So I'd give it the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah, for sure. It does. It always does feel like a little bit like cheating to bring a closer for a really strong album, because it's like, well, you don't have the context of the rest of the album. But, you know, I made do with what I had. Speaking of primal expression,
this
Billy,
is
what'd you
country
think?
Roads take me home to West Virginia.
I thought it was Lil Nas.
Yeah, this was great. I love Lil Nas. I looked it up on YouTube, and the one I see is 8 minutes. So I don't know if this version was 10 minutes, or if you're lying to me. Is it actually 10 minutes? Because the YouTube one is 8 minutes.
Oh shit, I think you're right. No, it is 8 minutes. Well,
I make an 8 minute song feel like 8 minutes.
Well, there you go, Jess. That's why it's actually, it doesn't feel like it's a song.
Okay, so I rescind some of my praise. Very good.
All right,
praise gone. No more current praise.
This song sucks. No, I'm just joking. I really like this song. The progression felt really intentional and was very well done. I loved how it felt sort of like a spiral, how it just kept coming back and then going, and it kept progressing, and then like that kind of roller coaster of ups and lows. And all the while, like Fishy said, I did really get the feel of like this, the music was chasing after the vocalist, sort of. And I really loved that feeling of it brought about a sort of uneasiness, especially with the instruments, the whining of the clarinets. It all had that uneasiness about the entire track, from start to finish. GS was a little picky on the vocalist, but I really liked his singing. I liked that effect that he had, that uneasiness perpetuates from his voice. I thought it was a really good track.
Oh, good. Glad to hear. Yeah, I think you would like this band.
Well, they only have 2 albums right now. It doesn't take too long to get through the discography. I'm getting a little tired, so maybe we should wrap up.
Which we were going to do anyway, so I'm not saying anything revolutionary, I guess. Anyway, yeah, this was a good episode. Good picks, everyone. For a little surprise, did P Chunks listen to the song? What did they think?
P Chunks doesn't have a mic. Wait, here.
So I thought it was really good. I enjoyed Ghost Rider-y kind of feel to it, along with just like country music. And I had another movie in mind. Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, just kind of like, I imagine like disco lights on like a dirt road, like you're just kind of seeing things and that sort of stuff.
Special guest.
Okay, cool. Special guest. All right, guys. Good work, everyone. That's
this could have been an email.
As my first time on here, I want to say thanks for having me on here. I really appreciate it.
Of course. You're welcome.
You're
going to
be replacing GS, so.
And oh god.
You're out of the band.
You need me.
We only have room for 8 members.
You need
8
me.
8 members? Are we crash test dummies?
We need the second violinist. All right. That's the show, guys. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you liked at least half of one of the songs. And this is the Music Smoothie signing off. Tip your waitresses. Kill your uncles.
Amen.
Thank you, Hamlet's ghost.
All right. Are you going to stop the recording?
And a women.
Yeah. I'm working on it.
No, just leave it going until the next episode. Call it a field recording
on the podcast. Yeah, this is my song I've made on the Discord called Field Recordings. It's all of
I'm going to bring music from people I know.
This is me. This is the sound of me sleeping for 9 hours.
That would be very avant-garde for me. I make interesting sleeping noises.
Oh, yes. Yes, we know. That would just be regular.
They give me anxiety.
That would just be regular music at that point, but more like Murr's Bell. All right. Hope you guys enjoyed that particular blend of the music smoothie. And remember to like us on Facebook, Instagram, follow us on Twitter at tmusicsmoothie. Our email is musicsmoothiepodcast if you want to send us anything. We are on Patreon as the Music Smoothie if you like what you hear and would like us to record consistently every week. Other than that, you know, listen to us anywhere on your favorite streaming service, and our music use is all fair use under the media criticism clause of fair use, and hope you guys have a wonderful day, and we'll see you next time. Swing, mother is my wife, my wife.